Good evening, everyone. So we are live, and this week, as I said, we are not going to talk about good code, but we're going to talk about shit code. So I have Jérôme with me. Welcome, Jérôme.
Hi, Vincent.
And so, Jérôme, you are the person that is running the Twitter account Shit Swift Dev.
Exactly.
So before we begin, maybe like you want to introduce yourself quickly and what this Twitter account is about?
Yeah, so I'm Jérôme, and I'm an iOS developer for 10 years. And I created this Twitter account a few months ago when I found a similar Twitter account, but for product management, which is called Shit PM, for Shit Product Manager. And I found it really funny, and I told myself I could do the same with Swift, and especially with some really weird Swift code. Maybe a little bit over-engineered.
So let's get into the topic right now. So the plan for this evening is that you're going to show us some Swift code that is, we could say, extremely over-engineered, but surprisingly, it works and it enables some things like that maybe we didn't think were possible, but... It's way too much over-engineered that we would recommend to have it in our code, but sometimes like understanding how it works, well, it's kind of interesting.
Yeah, it can be the kind of code that you are really proud of making when you found it. This is working. That's so smart. And then you push it and maybe someone will tell you on a pull request, but maybe not a good idea.
Exactly. So it's more like technical demos, I guess we could say. So yeah, I'm going to show your screen. I see also some familiar names in the chat. Good evening, Frank. Okay, so this software is hard. I'm trying just to have everyone. Okay, this time is correct.
So yeah, this one was more than a wink for the protocol programmed orienting language, popular session on the WWDC, and it's the fact that you can make a protocol for absolutely everything. So I wanted to do that for my first tweet on this Twitter account, and so I made a hello world, but protocol oriented. So I made a protocol hello world printable that can print an hello world, and then it's wonderful because thanks to protocol-oriented programming, I can make an int or a string or anything print an hello world, and this is absolutely fantastic.
So it's like the famous sentence at the beginning of the talk, which was something like, first, start with a protocol, and you take it and you go just way too far with it.
Yeah, I literally start my Twitter account with a protocol, so it's good.
So it's funny to see that, yeah, if you wanted to show something that is like the not the most idiomatic, but the most like, how do you say, like someone who goes like way too far in the most extremist Swift hello world, it's definitely this.
And in a real world example, we can find this kind of code, for example, when you have a protocol something to make API request, and you implement it, for example, on a view controller. So the view controller can fire network request. It's obviously a bad idea, and it's not protocol oriented at all. It's just a protocol. You extend everything with a protocol, but it doesn't work like that.
Yeah, exactly. Because that's what's kind of nice about this kind of code, is that when we really like think about it, we can maybe like get some insights or some lessons. So here, what's interesting is that actually you don't need a protocol to do this. You just need, I mean, it's just a static func, so it could be like any type. Basically, like you could have an hello world printer type with a static func, and anyone could call it, and you don't need to introduce protocol and extensions just for this one.
Yeah, exactly. So let's move to the next one.
Yeah,
a pair. So this one is from a need I thought I had, but plot twist, I didn't need it. I wanted to have a pair object which works like a tuple, but forcing the two member to be of the same type.
Okay.
And this is not compiling, of course, because you can't start a var name with a number. And it was, I think it was when the dynamic member lookup feature was just released. And yeah. I thought, this could be working. And I came up with this. So basically, we store the values in a tuple.
Yeah.
And we need the pair with the first and the second parameter. We need to use the tuple. And then, thanks to the dynamic member key pass, we pass a key pass from a tuple of T to a T member, which returns the T. I call the key pass on the tuple. And thanks to that, it works with the number key pass. So this is the equivalent for something like, sorry, something like that.
Yeah.
So this is a shortcut for that. And obviously you can do it. But yeah, maybe it's too much. It's too much for something like that. And I would say that if you really need to have a type with the two same values, you should make something not necessarily generic, but something more for the real use case you have. For example, my use case was that I wanted to have the old view controller as the new view controller for an animation. And so I wanted this. And the idea is maybe to have a structure with the old view controller and the new view controller. So everything is properly named and I don't have a number variable in the middle of everything.
Yeah, and what's really nice here is that we also learned something. We learned that tuples, they also have key path. So they really behave like actually much closer to a struct than what I would have like before this example. I actually hadn't realized that tuples, they also had key path, they also supported this syntax.
Yeah, they do. And for example, if you have labels on the tuple itself, not here, but here. Then you can also call the.
So you can also use this.
Yes. So.
Oh, that's nice.
So this is working as well, and yeah. This is working, but again, not really a good idea. And mostly, if you really want to do that, you can just, I think,
go with a type alias.
Yeah, make a type alias over
the tuple type, and you get all the features.
And you have exactly the same. So the dynamic member is really engineered. A simple type alias is working.
And indeed, like when you do it like this, it seems like more reasonable to have it in your code like this.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
Yeah, but what's funny is that so I've learned like when we rehearsed that you can have this key path on tuples. What's funny is that currently on the channel, I have a video that is an introduction to key path. It's still unlisted, it's not released. But now I'm finding out that some information are missing in the video. So it's kind of funny to see it. But it's a nice example to see, yeah, that there are some like surprising things that we can do with dynamic member lookup.
Yeah, but overall it's a really nice feature, and I do it use dynamic member lookup for different use cases, not this one, but it's really a feature I like much.
Yeah, because it's a great way to do like composition, but with the seamless access from inheritance. So it's kind of like, you know, it's often we say do composition over inheritance, but it's kind of like you can somehow get the best of both worlds up to a limit. But it's super interesting. Yeah. And I'm really curious to see, like, I don't know if like many frameworks from Apple use it a lot, this dynamic member lookup, but when they start using it a lot, we might see also some interesting patterns.
Yeah, for example, Binding in SwiftUI is using it, because you can make a binding for a nested property.
Oh yeah.
So Every time you call a property, you get a new binding, and in this new binding, you can also get a member through the key pass, and it gets a new binding, and so on. So for example, yeah, if you have SwiftUI. I don't know, maybe like that. Maybe it won't work like that, but yeah, if you have a binding here, maybe I can just do a constant for pair, and I need to have this mutable, otherwise it doesn't work, because dynamic member lookup are also working with mutable properties. So you can completely add a new value here. And here I think you can call something like that. So
you can get a binding on something that is nested.
Yeah, and here you get a binding for the first member. So I need the new value here. And if I call binding to wrap value equal intent,
we should see that. See
that
should update.
I need a writable key pass. And this should work, maybe, eventually. obviously, it makes a copy. It makes a copy of
the value type.
Yeah, it's a value type, so it makes a copy. We need to change it to class, and this isn't the same.
So you need to have reference writable, right?
Yeah. I have intent now. It's working.
Perfect.
So binding is using it, and I don't think I need reference. So binding in SwiftUI is using it, and we have many some cases like that in the in Apple frameworks that are using it.
And we have a question from Cedric, so I'm going just translate it in English. It's, do you have an example of add dynamic member lookup in your projects? Personally, I've seen that in Eric Swift. They use it now, and this way they can generate all the wrappers, all the bindings to expose UI kit, like all the UI controls property to Rx. They do it now with dynamic member lookup instead of using something like Sorcery or just writing it by hand.
Yeah, exactly. It works the same, but as a SwiftUI binding. And in my own project, I also have some examples. It's mainly for wrapper types like that. So if I have a generic wrapper for a specific use case, if it's relevant, I will add this feature so I can access to the members without having to doing it manually.
And I must say, on my part, I haven't used it that much outside of demos, but basically whenever if for instance you want to wrap for instance a third party framework or some existing APIs into your own type, for me that's basically like one of the killer use case. Okay, you were saying
let's move to the next one. So for the next one, I wanted to troll a little bit some rules in linters like SwiftLint, and especially the file length. So for example, here I have a file, for example, with a file length limit at 150, and obviously it breaks my linter, so I need to fix that. And you can do it the good way by refactoring your code or splitting responsibilities of your type, maybe. But I thought it was more funny to trick the linter and use a really weird feature, which is the ternary operator with because the auto closures from the ternary operator allows you to actually write any statement. So for example, you can write an estimation and you can assign a new value directly inside of the auto closure. So this should work.
Yeah, it's something that feels like when you see it like this, it looks more like C code than Swift code.
Yeah. So let's hope that Xcode will find a way to compile it. Maybe it's a too complex expression for Xcode. I don't know.
At least it looks pretty good from the syntax point of view.
Yeah, it should work, but I don't know. Could not compute signing task. Okay, I don't want to sign anything. let's try again.
I mean, when you make a live with a playground, it expects it's going to crash at some
point. But maybe it's a good opportunity to tell why it's not a good idea, because obviously Xcode cannot handle it correctly and it will make your compile time longer. But joke aside, the bad part of it is to have a side effect inside of a ternary operator, which is more used to return a value than to assign directly something. I don't know why it doesn't compile. I can restart Xcode, but it will break the screen sharing. Tell me, Vincent, if I do it.
If you restart Xcode, it probably will. I mean, maybe we can check on the next page, like if it's still like being buggy.
Okay, so let's move to the next one, which is a nice one, I think.
Yeah, this one, it's also a challenge, like to understand it.
Yeah, let's start with the call site. So does it compile and does it run? Yeah, it perfect. Runs. Okay, perfect. So the idea was to have a kind of syntax inspired from the JSON pass API. In JSON pass, you can have this kind of operators to access all keys or all values. And for some reason, I wanted to do that in Swift with actual subscript. And it works. So this is completely value code. But now, how it works? It's actually a small trick. Because, for example, subscript can accept a function. So here I have a function from wildcard to wildcard to void. And I completely ignore the subscript value, but I return directly the values. And I can just declare an operator with the same signature, which is wildcard, wildcard, and returns void. And then I can actually pass this operator into the subscript. It's like when you pass the plus operator in a reduce function. You can pass operators, it works. And here I use this trick to do that. And so it could be appealing like that, but I wouldn't advise you to do that, because it's not a syntax that we are used to see in Swift, in idiomatic Swift. So it's not a much benefit comparing to just dot keys. It doesn't save much, so I would say just don't do that. But this trick is actually used by the Swift standard library for the unbounded range operator. So I don't know if you know, in array, you can get an array slice, I think, by doing something like, for example, 1 to 2, and you get a slice of the two last values. You can do the same with a partial range. So here it's the same. You can do also this. Sorry, like this. So it's a syntax that we are used to have. But if you want to get a slice of the whole array, you don't have a non-bounded range operator. So they made it one, and you can actually do this. And this is using the same trick. So if you look at the code of the standard library, you can see that you have a non-bounded range enum, which has a postfix. So they are not using an infix operator like I did, but they are using a postfix operator. And then they define a type alias to the function signature, and they use this directly in the subscript, so they can return. It's not a slice; it's a subsequence. I made a mistake. It's not a slice; it's a subsequence, and you can return a subsequence from the start to the very end of the array of the collection.
Yeah, and what I find super interesting with this case, it's like kind of like the status that the operator has, because in this example, the operator is just like a symbol that is used to store a given type, but it's used like more like a variable name, basically.
Yeah, and actually in the code they added a comment saying we are doing this until we can have a variable name name like that. So yeah, you are completely right. It's interesting to see that it's not the technique that is bad in itself. It's yeah. More about the use case. So for example, here the use case is not really really convenient because we already have something idiomatic in Swift. But for ranges, what is idiomatic for ranges in Swift is to have operators. We have operator ranges operator for all kind of ranges. And it looks right to have an operator like that to express the fact that we want a subsequence for the whole array. And it would have been weird to have here something like subsequence or like that, for example.
Indeed. Yeah, well, it's like you have to like to be like to, I don't know, like to keep the same same line of thought like all the way. So yeah, indeed. But yeah. What I find like really really nice is that it's something that often happens is that in the standard library they often like use either some hacks or they use some ways of programming that if it was just like a developer that was using this, we would be like, is it really a good idea? But they can say, yeah, we are sure, like we are doing it. For instance, the unbounded range, what they use, that they use an enum as a namespace by providing no cases. And yes. It's something that's totally valid in Swift. But when you see it, you're like, yeah, but should I really like go along that way? And when you look at the standard library, they're like, yeah, it's fine. You can do it like this. It seems a bit weird, but enum can be used as a namespace.
Yeah, completely, yeah. So it's all about the use case and why we are doing something, and it's not about the technique itself. It's more about the use case. Let's see if the file length decided to compile again. Oh, I just understood that I actually never call this function, so this is why it's not there's nothing in the console. So now it's working. I have the 8 for the X, and if I do false, I have 8 for the Y. So it's working, it's valid, but there's no point of doing it.
Yeah, that's definitely like it doesn't feel like Swifty at all to do things this way.
Yeah, completely. And actually, you can do it a Swifty way, maybe by doing something like that. Up. It's not much better, but if you really want to save some lines for SwiftLint, it's a little bit better than the ternary operator assigning the new value.
Yeah, it's a much like better way to use this operator.
But if you want to change the constant, it's a little bit better, let's say.
Okay, shall we move on to the next one, which is
quite your favorite?
I think it's my favorite. It's the one I put in the miniature for the live.
Yeah, this one got a really a big success on Twitter, and for some reason, because it's a real one. So the idea was to have a type safe URL constructor, which is completely type safe because we don't have any string. It's directly I write the URL directly in the code like that. And I can change the domain, and it works the same.
And if you make a typo, so in HTTPS or in www, you're going to get a compiler error.
Yeah, for example, and I can even enforce HTTPS because HTTP is not compiling, so it's more secure for your code, you know. How does it work? Because, for example, the first trick here is to have actually this, because you might know that this is actually for comment.
Oh, yes.
So what is this magic? This is not actually a regular slash. It's a box drawing character. So in Unicode, you have some characters to draw boxes. And this is the diagonal box drawing character. So it's not really easy to type. You don't have it on your keyboard. So you can just copy paste it. And it's even true for this, because this isn't a regular colon, because you can't have colon, you can't have operators, because this is an operator. You can't have an operator starting with a colon, because it's to specify it.
Yeah.
So this is actually a Braille character. So I don't remember which letter it is, but this is not a regular colon. So first thing, this is really complicated to write with your hand.
It's basically like a phishing URL, but in Swift. Basically.
Yeah, exactly. So now we have two parts. We said that this is an operator. So we have a left-hand side and a right-hand side.
Right.
The left-hand side is really easy. It's just a scheme with a raw value named HTTPS. And the operator is just making an URL component, assign the scheme, assign the host, and return the URL with a forced unwrap. So this is not really safe, actually. And then on the right hand side, you can see that I have a host name, name www. But I just had that. And how the apple.com is working is, again, using the dynamic member lookup. But this time, it's the first version of the dynamic member lookup, which works with plain strings or even number, I think. So the idea is that whatever we are writing after the www dot, the compiler will pass it as a string to this subscript. So here I have a www hostname, and then I call dot apple. I get the dot apple here, the apple here, and I'm just creating a new hostname that append the string to the existing raw value, and I return an hostname. So that's all. It's that simple, and I can really add as much as I want. I'm not sure numbers are working. I don't remember. Yeah, it's working. For example, I had an overload. I don't know if I can do that. But I think that you can have a specific overload for integers. No, maybe not. you can just have a thing. So obviously, this isn't enough to build really real URLs, because you can't add a query. And I know that some people on Twitter answered me and tried to do it, but it was some weird tricks and it doesn't look like to a real URL. But I think it's already a good way to create type safe URL.
Yeah, and what's funny is that the way that you use dynamic member lookup, actually, it's quite like faithful to the spirit of the feature, we could say, because the goal is to be able to deal with things that are inherently dynamic, and basically like writing a URL. It's kind of like querying an environment variable. It's a string, like in the end, so it does make sense to use the feature for this. And so Frank is asking, how could you specify a port? I guess that would be also like maybe also using the Braille character. You could like
maybe you can do a postfix. Let's try that. Let's try a postfix operator.
So it's going to be once again this Braille character.
Yeah, and then we can add a postfix func to the host name. Host name.
And I guess for the port.
Let's do something like that.
Yeah.
I don't need the nil, and maybe I can shadow the variable, set the port.
I guess what you need to get is infix, I guess.
It's an infix too. But I will need some to set some precedence, so I'm not sure it would work. Let's say multiplication precedence and addition precedence. And I need the port
here. Int. And then so you're going to return the host name. And then
I don't need the infix keyword here.
And now is it going to?
And yeah, it worked. Yeah, we have a port. And then I could add anything else because it's still a host name. No, actually I can't. I would need to do that to be able to do this.
Oh yes.
And the port disappeared. Obviously, because I don't set the port here. Yeah, but this should move the 12 at the end. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, this is not working well anymore.
But the chat is applauding the fact that you've managed to implement it live.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks. Don't ask me for the query because I really tried hard. But if you have an idea in the chat, feel free to suggest it, and I will try to live coding it. But I really don't have an idea for the query because the difficult part is that after the query, it can be absolutely anything, and you can't. I can't cheat with the www. Because not all queries are like that. So yeah, it's really hard for a query to be able to write absolutely anything.
Yeah, and what's also like kind of insightful is the lesson that it's not because something like an API looks type safe that inside is not doing things like actually using strings and using force unwrap and this kind of things. Like you can have like the security of type safety, but for instance, like SwiftUI's environment, the API is type safe, but if you try to retrieve something that is not registered, it's going to crash, and the type safety app doesn't like necessarily prevent these kind of things.
Yeah, exactly. And here, a plain old string is just
equally
better on all the parts, all the way. So it's just two characters. So so don't be afraid of a plain string. It works. It works really great. But yeah, it was more to criticize the fact that sometimes we want so much to have type safety, but we might not consider that it's not really more safe, it's not really more convenient, and we shouldn't strive for it at any cost.
So Frank is asking, is ZWG allowed as an operator name? I'm not sure what a ZWG is actually.
Characters are not allowed, but I wonder if this is the name of something else. But Frankie is knowing much more stuff than we do. Zero-widgener, okay. I don't think the zero-widgener. So it's basically the space with no width. This is not allowed because it considered as a white space character, so it's not allowed. But I see some tricks using an actual operator for representing a space, but it was a fake character. I don't know if I can I can find it. But you know, it's a little caret at the bottom. Maybe it's I don't remember how it's named. But yeah, you can simulate a space operator, but you actually have a character printed on the
screen. Yeah,
on the screen.
Yeah, and I'm thinking also like if the goal is to have a shortcut syntax to write URLs in Swift, maybe like a better way to go would be to just like make the type URL conform to expressible by string literal, for instance. You have the shortcut, and the fact that it's still stringly typed is still like apparent, and it's not like being hidden behind a syntax that does not provide that much type safety.
I think I made a mistake. It's working. I just found how it is. So for example, in the GitHub repository Esoteric Swift, there's an example of the basic language, and it's like that.
I'm going to put the link in the chat if people want to check it out.
It's not my code. It's not my code, but they're implementing a basic interpreter like this. So this is a kind of space operator, and then you can do something like this. So you write the line count, the line number, You say print, for example, you go to, and then you run, and here you have an infinite loop of hello world. So I will stop it before it breaks my Xcode. But yeah, you can simulate a space operator like this. So
oh, yeah, I this see is. It.
So yeah, that was the
type
safe URL operator.
So what do you have next for us?
The next thing is not really code. it's more a joke about architectures, because you know we have a ton of architectures pattern in iOS world, and I found it wasn't enough, even something like Viper is too coupled together. Entities are too coupled together, so I decided to make my own architecture pattern inspired from Viper, but where I split again responsibilities. So for example, the interactor is split between an interactor and an updater, because it's not actually the same thing to update and to interact. And the router is split between connector and hypervisor, because we want a part that connects pieces together, and then we want to hypervisor to hypervise everything and make sure that everything is working. So I renamed some entities, like the entity becomes the kernel, because why not? After all, a model has been a renamed entity to make a nice Viper word. So yeah, now we have the Pikachu architecture. And it's definitely the best architecture, because you have more letters, so it's great. What do you think, Vincent?
Actually, I'm not seeing the page on the screen. I'm thinking like maybe like the picture froze. That could be possible.
You should have told me that before. Sorry, because I closed. Xcode mistake earlier.
So I'm going to put us both on screen while we solve it. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. Sorry for... It's no problem. I'm going to also like fix everything. And while I'm doing it, you can just like show us the image.
Yeah. So this is the image. So we have the MVC, model view controller. Then we can split the controller into a view model and coordinator. It's not really bad, but we can say it's bad. And then for Viper, we can split the view model into an interactor and a presenter. We rename the model into entity, and then we can have the Pikachu, which is even more a part of the architecture. So I don't know if we can do even a bigger architecture name, but I think this one is already nice.
And this
just imagine how much protocols it makes in your project.
It can be something that for like every April 1st, you can like just use it and try and talk about it seriously and see like just. I think if you don't write Pikachu, it's like up until the moment where you've written Pikachu, it can all seem like kind of like legit, maybe a bit over-engineered, and it's when you like write the name that it gives it all away.
Yeah. And actually, it was funny because in the answer on Twitter, some people didn't realize it was a joke. So I've been insulted a lot, like, but are you stupid or what? So yes, this is actually stupid. So
that's so, the entire point of it.
Yeah. That's the point. The next one, if you want, isn't something I came up with. It's something that someone sent me on my Twitter account, and I found it funny, so I can share it. So if you want to send, we can send it. This playground is available on GitHub, so if you want to find again the Twitter account, it's easy. And the idea was to have all the functions of your project in an enum. So obviously it's better because again it's type safe. You can't have a new function or not working or something like that. So it uses the call as function feature, and you can do it like this. So for example, you implement hello world with a print hello world, and you can implement a fizzbuzz with this switch, and then you can call function hello world and function fizzbuzz. So the syntax is a little bit weird, but I really liked it because I wanted to troll a little bit, and this remind me a little bit the reducers in some popular architectures. Actually, the actions because you have all actions as enum cases, and then you have a reducer that iterate by switch over the enum and do something else in each case. So it reminded me this kind of architecture. So I found it funny to talk about that. But yeah, I'm not criticizing this kind of architecture. I like some of them myself. So, but it was funny.
And I was thinking, so maybe what we can do, since we still have some time, is the part about the basic interpreter, because I hadn't realized that your screen was not updating, but maybe I guess you can create a new playground page and copy and paste the code from GitHub, and because it's quite interesting to see like the way that it works. Yeah.
So the basic operator, so this has been written by Joe Groff, which is working on the Swift project itself. So obviously the infinite loop works. It's fine. So the idea is to have a basic interpreter like this. So you add the line. Then you have this space operator, which is not really a space, but it's a special character. And then you write your statement, and this is an autoclosure. And what it does is that it adds the closure into a stack, into a dictionary. So you have the line for the key, and you have the statement for the value. So it just does that, it just happened. And then when you call run, it's actually a variable. And what it does is that it iterates infinitely. And for each line, it finds the program, it executes it like this, and then it finds the next one. And so on. I think it's funny, but obviously it's weird because you can, for example, write this and the print will be overwritten by the goto, and you still have an infinite loop, but it doesn't print anything. So it's not really a really basic, real basic interpreter, but I think it's funny. It's funny again. So
yeah, it's nice to see like how in like a very like few number of code actually you can like implement a very like simple code interpreter and yeah, it's like you see like you do have the while loop that is going to like go over, take the instruction, run it, get the number of the next instruction, and the fact that you can do all of this in Swift is it's a nice technical demo, basically.
Yeah. But it's not. It's on the GitHub name Esoteric Swift Code. So it's a good name. It's esoteric, And I don't see anyone really implementing this in a real project. In opposite to what I try to do on my account, I will try to find code that you might be tempted to implement for a real project, but you shouldn't.
Definitely not. And we have a remark. Eric is saying that he really likes the way the greater than or equal operator looks like. And I think it's actually like, it's just a font, right? It's
Yeah, it's the JetBrains Mono. I don't know if you see my...
I can see that it only selects half of the correct area.
Yeah, it's JetBrains Mono font. And you also have the FiraCode font, which also have this kind of ligatures. But the one I'm using is it's JetBrains Mono. And yeah, I really like it as well.
Yeah, it's really nice. And the fact that they use ligatures, it's super smart because like it's still the real character in your code. When you do a code review, it doesn't appear. It's purely like on your display, on your front.
Yeah, and it's funny because you can move the caret in the middle of the of the stuff. And if you add a space, it separates the two
characters. The game is up. It shows like what's happening behind the scenes.
Yeah, the same for arrows. Even multiple rows like this, it's really nice.
Yeah, it's really like I think one. I hope that one day Xcode is going to ship with this kind of feature like out of the box. Yeah, that would be kind of nice.
There's the San Francisco monofont, but they don't want to the ligatures way, and. The infinite loop just made me no froze. Okay. So yeah, this is the basic interpreter.
I think it's also like we're getting close to the end of the hour, but that's perfect because we have covered we've covered everything that we wanted to cover. That's nice. We had some questions to kind of like try to do some live coding. So that's perfect because at first we were thinking like, should we record? Should we do it live? And live was definitely like the good option.
Yeah, I think so.
So I think it's time to wrap things up. So in the description of the video, you have several links and I can only encourage that you go and check out Jerome's Twitter account and the Sheets with Dev Twitter account and just follow them and... to stay updated when there is new content available.
Yeah, hopefully after the WWDC, where I hope they will have some new features, but not announced in the Swift Evolution process, like they did for the property wrappers, the result builders, and features like that. They didn't announce it before the Swift UI release, so I hope there are still some features like that will be announced. So I can play with them and write a really awesome over-engineer the code.
I'm thinking like when you take a look at everything you have with async await, the actors, the sendable functions, and all these kind of things. I guess when all of this like stuff gets released, there is going to be like some good candidates because there is a lot of new syntax, of new concept with a lot of like very interesting edge cases.
Yeah, probably.
All right. Well, thank you all for attending this week's live. It was super fun. So I just have to say, well, thank you, Jerome, for joining me this evening. It was the first time that I had a French guest, I think, on a live. So it was super nice to do it. And well, thank you all for joining and participating. And see you all next week for another live. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.